Thanks for the flowers given in loving memory of Bobby Baird by John and Margie Baird and Tom, Sydney, Tiffany, and Ashley Elbertson. Number of highlights from all of our announcements. The Advent devotional is due today, and there are pages out in the assembly room to give you guidance on samples.
Prayer requests for our prayer time in service?
Yes.
They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to the springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.
Oh, my God.
loved us, shared our trials, and still allowed us to become what we are, we give thanks. For those who led us out of our own personal slaveries and taught us the meaning of being free, we give thanks. For those who now surround us, family, friends, those who share our secrets, those who wish to know us better, and those of the community of saints who give us courage and hope to live, we give thanks. We give thanks and remember those who have died over the past 12 months since our last All Saints Sunday. Lucas Sykes, grandson of Martha Sykes, will light our candles as the names are read. Martha Sykes. be reading names of people who have died. But as Christians, we have something very special that's hidden to other people. When you get home, if you want to break this open, shake it. Hold it up to your ear. Shake it. Feel that? Hear that stuff shaking? Inside the middle are five doves. Five little tiny pieces of shells that look like doves. And they stand for peace and love and life and the Holy Spirit. So even in the sad times when people die, God gives us hope. So, would anyone like another one so that you can break one open and still keep one as whole? Okay, Ari, you want one more?
All things new. he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, and the end." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Someone here is suffering from discouragement. Another has been verbally put down at her job without anyone else noticing. Several are here today because of a death in their family. A brother in Christ has a paralyzed prayer life, but they are too embarrassed to share it with anyone else. A sister in Christ is being abused by her husband. No one believes her because he is seen as such a gentle man in public. All of these friends here today are looking for Jesus. Others are grieving today in their times of worship in Staten Island, the Bronx, and the Queens, recovering from a time of tragedy in their lives. You may be the one sent here by God to listen with an open heart and mind to someone else who is hurting and alone and afraid. Along the course of a cross-country race, some runners drop out exhausted, poorly pacing the strength that they have. Some take wrong turns. Some are tripped up and fall, or simply trip themselves. Others stay together as a group, encouraging their teammates. Now, in cross-country, the team score is the sum of the first five finishers for each team. So it is the low score that wins in cross country. But if you have a race winner, and then the other four on your team are way back, your score will be much higher and you will lose. But if your team stays together, your score will be lower. And so a perfect score would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or adding those numbers together, a score of 15. People in church need to run together also, as a team, not just one way out in front of the others, but group together so that we can buttress one another up during the difficult time. We hear these words from Hebrews. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, we can look back in Hebrews chapter 11 to the hall of heroes, to those who have preceded us and have suffered in their lives. We can look back on those lives that have inspired us, as these stars represent today. Those who have proven themselves courageous against seemingly hostile and insurmountable difficulties. For they believed in the living God, and they lived the faith of Psalm 42. "Why are you cast down, O my soul? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my help and my God. My soul is cast down within me, therefore I remember you." The stars are our great cloud of witnesses on your left and on your right. They surround us when we recall their names and how the events in our lives were shaped by them. We have to get rid of a weight that slows us down. The letter to the Hebrews continues, "Let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, laying aside the weight and burdens that slow us down." These are the grudges, the prejudice we need to forgive. When we're running a race, there's something in our bodies that kind of gives out and says, stop, you can't go any further, you're tired out, or you don't deserve this anymore. The race is getting longer, and the hills are getting steeper, and temptations grow more powerful in our lives day by day. We may not like the course that is laid out before us. Pain is inevitable as we run that race, but misery is optional. Many parts of the marathon make us forget Jesus. His joy was based on the cross that was set before him, looking to the victory. And you and I are worth it, and one day we will finish the race. Until then, it is God, when we remember what God has done, who will lift up our drooping knees and our sore bodies. We need to encourage one another as we press on to that goal. Runners in cross country cannot just think of themselves. They must always be thinking of their teammates and seeing where they are. The teams have seven. It's just five of the finishers that count. And sometimes that sixth or seventh one on the team may be the one that ends up placing third or second or first for the team. Encouraging one another. God's kingdom is like that. It's laid on the foundation of steadfast love. And steadfast love is the love that encourages us. Especially when we slow down or get discouraged, when the very heart is taken out of us. Think back to 1804, when Lewis and Clark began their expedition of discovering the land of the Louisiana Purchase. They had a large keel boat made over in Pittsburgh, and it was stocked with supplies and weapons and ammunition. Their trip, which was to take 2 years, ended up halfway through running into a river that was too shallow for that keel boat. The safety of that boat had to be given up. It was sent back to St. Louis. And they went on, loading what they could into six small canoes and two large rowboats. That night, Meriwether Lewis wrote in his diary, "The picture which now presented itself to me was a most pleasing one, entertaining as I knew the most confident hope of succeeding in the voyage, which had formed a darling project of mine for the past 10 years. I could but esteem this moment of my departure as among the most happy of my life." Here was someone halfway through a 2-year voyage away from family, going into smaller provisions with less ammunition, fewer supplies, and saying, what a wonderful way to continue our trip. You and I have those defining moments in our lives, a time of radical abandonment when we leave behind what has held us down, and a time of radical trust, looking to Jesus and realizing that our lives as Christians involves hard work. We stumble when we follow our own courses, but we must always keep Jesus in sight, especially in times of deep grief. There's a story about Frank and Wanda and their two children as they go through a time of struggle in their race. Wanda kept telling herself, no turning back now. She and her husband exchanged looks, for they had begun a new journey. Their 7-year-old did not want to move from his home to go to Arizona, a distant place. You'll be able to explore the desert, his mom tried to sound encouraging. Besides, Arizona is where the doctor says Jimmy may be able to get better. They had their doubts also. Their family and their friends said, don't make the trip. Is this sensible? Besides, Jimmy is going to die anyway. Even a doctor in Arizona wrote them and said, don't come. There is no hope. But Jimmy's doctor in town had said that his nephritis was really taking a toll with all of his excess fluids his body was retaining. The tough winters in Illinois were too much for him. There were no guarantees, but going to a desert area might help, even though the only home they had ever known was in Illinois. Wanda's mother had written them a letter, "Trust in the Lord always with all thine heart, and lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths." That scripture from Proverbs 3:5 had inspired her in tough times in her life, and now she hoped it would sustain them in their journey to this new land. She could testify as to what God had done in her life and how God had been present for her. The drive cross country gave them time to think about what they were leaving behind and where they were headed. Transition, and to make the transition between what was new in their lives and what was old. What had become a burden, slowing them down and making them stumble, and what would free them. As the geography changed, something inside Wanda and Frank changed as well. Slowly, their anxiety about what they were leaving behind turned to an anticipation about what was coming. They saw the 70-foot cactus, unique to the Sonoran Desert, its own world, a new world where they were headed. Trust in the Lord. The phrase of Scripture was repeated over and over again in their hearts and in their minds. They arrived, and Frank went to apply for a job, and he was hired immediately. They said to each other, "How God provides." The first doctor gave them no hope, but a second one did. And when they left home in Illinois, their pastor had said, "Don't wait to find a new church, thinking your church membership here is better. Find a new church right away." When Jimmy got sicker, members of their new church were reaching out in many caring ways, including watching Billy so Wanda and Frank could be with Jimmy in the hospital. For those who trust in the Lord, life is not always easy, and sometimes it gets harder, and so it did with them as Jimmy suffered more and more, and after 3.5 years, Jimmy died. For Wanda and for Frank, it was the end of their hopes, the end of their anticipation of a miracle cure, yet at the same time, they felt surrounded by the love of their new family of Christians that helped ease their pains. They missed Jimmy in 1,000 little ways, yet they believed in the power of God and the bonds of love that were now reaching out to them from their new neighbors. And one of their new friends asked, "When will you be moving back home?" "What do you mean?" Wanda replied. "This is our home." The desert had begun to grow on them because of their new friends. Just as Jesus was with his disciples in that lonely place when he would go off to pray, and that became their home, so Arizona became the home for Wanda and Frank. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Wherever love is, there is home. Wanda walked outside, gazing with thanksgiving at the desert landscape around her. You and I have been in desert times in our lives, lonely places where you feel deserted. Notice how similar the words are. In the desert times, we feel deserted. Deserted by your family, by your friends, and even by God. But God wants to meet us in the wilderness, in those deserted places of our lives. The times when you are without money, when you are without friends, when you are without hope, there are spiritual deserts when you are deaf to God's voice. Every area of our lives has a potential to become a desert, and most are unchosen deserts. Because to enter into the way of God is to enter a desert. To learn to live in the desert is to remain oriented to God and not on ourselves, but through the desert times, to meet God precisely in the place where we can depend on him and no one else, not even ourselves. Eugene Peterson has paraphrased our text this morning. When you find yourselves flagging in your faith, go over Jesus' story again, item by item, that long litany of hostility Jesus plowed through. And that will shoot adrenaline through. through your souls. Do you know of people who have dropped out of the race? God gives us the power to see in others what we ourselves have suffered, to see each other as persons. Jesus is the pioneer of our faith. He got things started. And when our love becomes shallower, conceited, when our own insights become short-sighted, God disciplines us and sends us friends to walk alongside of us until our eyes are on Jesus once again. When we are most thirsty, God provides water in the desert, just as God did for the people of Israel. Remember, we stand on the shoulders of those who precede us. These names on the stars are the ones whose shoulders bear us and our burdens. And so we give thanks to God for those who have shined like stars through all eternity, and especially during our desert times. When our members die, when our members move, when our youth grow up, there is a challenge to find new ways to church. If we don't see that need ourselves in our Presbyterian churches, we better start listening to those outside of our walls who often see the need for change better than we do. There's really only one choice: either deep change or slow death. And I am convinced that God will continue to give this congregation the resources to meet those challenges in new and creative ways that involve change, like our community dinners and our Presbyterian Women's Mission Room. 13 years ago, Reverend Harold Kaser, former pastor of this church, wrote a devotional about their four children, including Kathy, who died recently. Mrs. Kaser and their four children always sat in the balcony during Sunday morning worship. On one occasion, when communion was being celebrated, Sharon asked her mother why children at that time were not served the bread and the juice. She was told that children had to wait until they were old enough. But when communion was celebrated the next time, little Sharon came prepared. As the elements were passed, Sharon opened her purse and took out a piece of bread and gave a small portion to each of her siblings. No words were spoken and none were necessary, but God's presence was felt in the balcony that morning. Later, Dr. Kaser said that he reflected many times on that incident and was convinced that God's finest revelation often comes through the lives of our children. He wrote, "The simple gifts they give us speak eloquently about the divine presence of God, who came as a child and in his ministry took the little children in his arms and said, 'Let the little children come to me, for to such belongs the kingdom of heaven.'" Our saints have finished running the race, while our children are needing us to continue to press on toward the goal together as a team. But the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. They are at peace. They shine like stars through all eternity.
Thank you.
dedication.
O Creator God, owner of all, thank you for considering us as your people. We are overwhelmed with the magnitude of the gift of your Son. We truly want to respond with generosity to your faithfulness, generation after generation. Please be patient with us as we learn to let go of what is yours, but what we thought was ours. We pray in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and only by your grace. Amen.
Let us join together in our invitation. Jesus, come, for we invite you, guest and master, friend and Lord.
Now, as at a former table, speak and let us hear your word.
Lead us through our need or doubting, hope be born and joy restored.
Jesus, come, transform our pleasures, guide us into paths unknown.
Bring your gifts, command your servants, let us trust in you alone.
Jesus, come, in new creation, heaven brought near in power divine.
Give your unexpected glory in your gifts of bread and wine.
Rouse the faith of your disciples.
Come, our first and greatest sign.
Surprise our dullness, make us willing to receive.
More than we can yet imagine, all the best you have to give.
Let us find your good images, taste your love, believe and live.
Let us pray. Lord God, we lift up to you all your servants that we remember this day, those saints who have preceded us, and those saints that we call our children, whose lives have yet to mature. We thank you for the ways in which the inspiration of lives past can give to those children that maturity of growing up in homes and in churches of faith. We pray especially for the families that we remember today, for all those who have suffered loss, for those whose faith has been challenged, for those whose loneliness leaves them without friends. We pray that you would use us to comfort others, to be instruments of your peace. We pray especially for the family of Gordon Kendall as we give thanks for the life of Polly. We thank you for our mothers and for our fathers, for our brothers and for our sisters. We thank you for the challenges that you give us day by day to rescue those whose lives have been in harm's way. We thank you especially for the ways in which governments come together to help those who are at loss. Continue to be with those who are in treatments, those who are waiting for the results of doctors' exams. We thank you that our Christian faith continues to grow and to be challenged, to become lives of love as well as obedience. Teach us not to judge others as we await our final judgment by you. Continue to be with us this week as we pray especially for those who are running for office. Help us to call to mind the best that is within us, for we acknowledge the sin that runs through our history as a nation, the displacement of Native peoples, the disregard for life, racial injustice, economic inequity, regional separation. And yet we profess a deep and abiding gratitude for the goodness of ordinary people who have made sacrifices, who have sought opportunities, who have journeyed to this land as immigrants and strengthened its promise in successive generations, who have found freedom on these shores and defended this freedom at tremendous cost. Be with us in the days that are near. Remind us that your ways are not our ways, that your power and might transcend every nation, that those who follow your Son, Jesus Christ, be a peaceable people in the midst of division. Give us a passion for peace, justice, and freedom that breaks down walls of political partisanship. Grant us wisdom. Grant us courage for the facing of this hour and the living of these days. For this we ask in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Together, let us forever the same manner also when they had supped, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. All of you drink of this. For as often as you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death till he comes again."
Thank you.
beside you on your left and on your right, in front of you and behind you, will be an encourager. And may the grace of our peace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you now and always. Amen.
Cups too.